Assalamualaikum and hello everyone. Students, we are studying our first chapter, Heredity and Evolution, and we have been learning about different evidences of evolution. Okay, so till now we have seen about morphological evidence, then anatomical evidence, then vestigial organs, embryological evidence, and now we are going to study about paleontological evidences. So paleontological evidences means paleontology. Paleontology is the branch of science which studies about fossils of animals and plants. So what are fossils? You know, dead remains of plants and animals which are preserved underground are called fossils, right? So all the study about fossils of plants and animal is called paleontology, and we are going to study about paleontological evidences that supports evolution, right? So see, a question may arise in your mind that which organisms existed millions of years ago, right? So this can how we can tell this? This secret is hidden in the earth, and this is this secret can be known with the help of study of fossil. So study of fossil is an important aspect in terms of study of evolution, right? So these impressions of dead remains of plants and animals which are preserved underground due to various disasters like flood, earthquake, volcano, they remain trapped inside the earth. Such study of fossil supports the study of evolution or provides the evidence of evolution. And how? We will see. See, students, we have learned about isotopes, right? Neutron number changes. So if you remember, carbon has isotope carbon 14, right? Carbon 12 and carbon 14. Out of that, carbon 14 is radioactive or unstable valence, right? So you know that carbon, there is carbon consumption from animals and plants. Means while they take food, while they eat food, they consume, they use carbon to prepare their food, right? Animals, they eat food at that time, carbon is consumed, and plants, when they prepare food, at that time they take carbon dioxide and they use it for preparing their food, right? So carbon consumption of these animals and plants, when these animals or plants die, this carbon consumption stops, right, after their death. And since then, only decaying process of carbon 14 occurs continuously. Means what? Carbon 12 is the natural form of a carbon isotope, right, that is present. And the carbon 14 is the radioactive one. Means what? The unstable one, right? So after the death of animals or plants, this carbon 14 being unstable, being radioactive, it goes on decaying. Decaying means it again goes on decomposing to its the stage or the stable form with having less energy, right? That means it goes back to carbon 12 due to decaying, right? So this decaying process, it goes on in carbon 14. Both the carbon isotopes are consumed. Out of that, carbon 14 starts decaying even after the death of plant because it is radioactive, right? So in case of dead bodies of these plants and animals, instead of the ratio between this carbon 12 and 14, instead of remaining constant after death, actually it should have been constant, right? Because the animals and plants are dead. But being radioactive, that carbon 14 is decaying. It is going on decomposing, right? Into the stable form. Now after that, this ratio of carbon 12 and 14, it should have been constant, but since carbon 14 is decaying, this ratio is changing continuously. And because carbon 12 is non-radioactive and carbon 14 is radioactive, so this ratio of carbon 12 to carbon 14 is changing continuously, right? Because carbon 12 already it stopped being stable after the death of animals or plants, it stopped. But carbon 14 is still decaying since it is radioactive, right? So that ratio is continuously changing. One quantity is remaining constant and the other one is changing. So the ratio also become imbalanced, right? So the time which passed since the death of that animal or plant can be calculated. How? By measuring the radioactivity of carbon 14. Carbon 12 already it stopped, carbon 14 is still decaying. So you can find, you can calculate the time at which the plant or animal has died. How? By measuring the radioactivity of carbon 14, means how much it decayed, from when it decayed, right? And the ratio of carbon 14 to carbon 12 present in their body can be calculated, right? From that ratio will be calculated. So this method is called carbon dating method. Carbon dating method means we find out the date with the help of carbon isotopes. From the with the help of carbon isotopes we found the date at which that plant or animal died, right? So this method is called carbon dating method, and it is used in paleontology for determining the age of our fossils, human fossils, right? That means from this we can come to know that plant, that buried fossil belongs to which era or which period. You understand now? So this is also evident. This paleontology also provides evidence of evolution. Through carbon dating method we can find out which animals belong to which period, right? So once the age of fossil is determined by such technique, it becomes very easy to deduce the information about other organisms, right? So if you see the picture in your textbook, see one picture is given there. See this picture. If you can see this picture in your textbook, see the structure of ground level and fossils, this one. If you observe this picture, see this diagram represent the structure of ground level and fossils. This is different layers and fossils are there, remnants or impressions of organisms that are preserved under the ground, right? Now see here, this part, the fossils of invertebrates, then pisces, right? Then next is some reptiles, amphibians, reptiles are found in here, right? Now see fossils of, if you observe this diagram, fossils of invertebrates, pisces, amphibians and some reptiles, these are found in lowermost level of ground, right? The lowermost level of ground, that indicates that they have evolved around the Paleozoic era, right? See here, era is also given. This part here, it is written Paleozoic era. So these fossils of invertebrate, pisces, reptiles, these amphibians or pisces, they belong to Paleozoic era because their fossils were found in the lowermost layer of soil, and this lowermost layer of soil belongs to Paleozoic era. Understood? And then see fossils of reptiles here, this one. These fossils of reptiles were found in the middle layer of the ground, right? This layer, this is the middle layer. So these reptiles were found in the middle layer of the ground. That indicates what? That these fossils, they date back to Mesozoic era. Here it is written Mesozoic era. So these reptiles belong to which era? Mesozoic era, because this middle layer belongs to Mesozoic era. Then next, the uppermost layer, right? The topmost layer on the ground, it has fossils of aves and mammals, right? All the birds and mammals. And that indicates that they are evolved in Cenozoic era, right? Now, do you understand this diagram? So, what does it mean? That the presence of fossils of animals in these different layers of soil, this indicates that it is this indicates the progressive development that took place, right, in animals and plants. Understood now? So from that we come to know that all the vertebrates have been slowly originated from invertebrates, right? So it also provides the evidence, that is paleontological evidence of evolution. Now next we will see connecting links. Connecting links. What are connecting links? To connect, right? So link. So see here now. See, some plants and animals show some morphological characters by which they can be related to two different groups. Some plants and animals, they show morphological characters by which they can be related to two different groups. Means what? They have the characters of one group also and other group also, right? Hence they are called as connecting links. Understand? They connect these two groups. That's why they are called as link between these two groups, that is connecting links. For example, in peripatus characters like segmented body, they have, see, picture is given in your textbook of peripatus, you can see that. So in peripatus they have segmented body, they have thin cuticle or covering like skin, and they have parapodia like organs that are present on them. So these are the characters that are present in peripatus. Similarly, they also show tracheal respiration through trachea, right? So and also they have open circulatory system like arthropods. They have open circulatory system, and tracheal respiration is different, right? So this indicates that the peripatus is connecting link between annelids and arthropods, because it has characters of both those, all animals which belongs to annelid group and also arthropod groups. So since it has the characters of both the group, it is considered as connecting link between these two group. Understood? Similarly, one more example is there, duck bill platypus. See, usually these questions always come in exam. Maybe in give reason also they will ask that peripatus is a connecting link between annelids and arthropods, something like this. So you have to describe like this. Okay, so one more example is duck-bill platypus. Now duck-bill platypus, they lay eggs like reptiles, but it shows relationship with mammals. Because there is presence of mammary glands and hairs on their body. So they show all the some characters of mammals, and they show some characters of reptiles, of laying eggs and having mammary glands and hairs like mammals. So they connect between these two groups, right? So they are also called as connecting link. One more example is given there of lungfish. Lungfish performs the function of respiration with lungs. Irrespective of being fish, they respire with the help of lung. And these examples indicate that all the mammals are evolved from reptiles and amphibians are evolved from fishes. Understood? So this is the proof of evolution. These connecting links, since they are having the characters of one of the group and other group also. From all these three examples, you come to know that mammals are evolved from either reptiles and amphibians are evolved from fishes. Understood? So far we have seen all the evidences of these things. Morphological evidence, then anatomical evidence, paleontological evidence, embryological evidence, then vestigial organs, connecting links, right? So all the evidences are being done. So we have completed this part. In our next video, we will study about Darwin's theory of natural selection, and Lamarckism is also there. One small concept is there that we will see. Okay, thank you.